So good morning, everyone. Welcome to Saturday. You made it to Saturday. That's the good news. We're really happy to start the day off with our keynote speaker, Chris Jones, a real dear friend to PPMD and now luckily a board member of the organization. Many of you met him, his family, and his son, Mitchell, online through Mitchell's journey, where he opened up his heart and his family, and his personal story about his son. I'm delighted to invite him up here to provide today's keynote address. So, Chris Jones.
Well, thanks for letting me spend a few minutes with you guys today. I love PPMD, and to be able to see what goes on the board level has been really fascinating. There's a whole lot of really smart people at the table there. I'm the least of them. They're all brilliant, but they have such great minds and inquisitive minds and compassionate hearts, and they're working so hard to solve this riddle. And we should be so lucky to have them fighting for our families. The address today, the thing I wanted to talk about was the pursuit of happiness and some surprising discoveries along the journey through life. And I'm not a scientist, and I don't think I ever will be, but I love people, and I love families, and I love making a life of significance. And so I hope that some of the things I'll share today, you can take with you and apply on whatever level you feel is appropriate. So my sweet wife was not able to make it, and she wanted to send her love, but I have a couple of kids at home that are just too old to be left home alone. So they're good, and don't let their cute smiles trick you. They're good kids, but their friends sometimes can talk them into crazy things. So my third son, for those that don't know, his name was Mitchell, and he was diagnosed with DMD at the age of 3, and we had a very interesting journey with his life. He was my best friend and my little soulmate. I loved everything about that little boy, and he always tagged along with me wherever I went. At the age of 10, we learned, just after he turned 10, we learned he had heart failure. And the doctors tried for about a year to stem the deterioration, and he was one of those anomalies, and I had to say goodbye to him in a little less than a year. And I think here's just one thing I wanted to share. The majority of life can be described probably in one sentence, that it just doesn't go as planned, and that's okay. We can make it through it. I want to share with you in this keynote about a few years of our life, during some of the more difficult aspects of our life, and things we did to find joy and purpose and meaning in our journey. And the reason why I chose these years is this is when the storm clouds really started to get dark. This is where we had a difficult time dealing with new discoveries regarding our son's condition. You will probably relate to a lot of this. Over the years, we had this increasing feeling of isolation. You know, people slapping you on the back at a barbecue, looking at our sons and just say, oh, he looks great, you're fine, you dodged a bullet. And nothing is more isolating than the naive optimism of people that just don't know better. And so that isolation began to mount over the years. In addition to that, our sense of certainty began to deteriorate. And because the pathways can be so different sometimes, the further you get down the path, the harder it is to get any sense of certainty. In addition to that, the medical complications began to increase. And when we found out our boy had heart failure, it was very, very rapid. Add to that, as we all know, the peaks and valleys of stress. How could anyone find happiness and joy against the backdrop of stuff like this, right? Isolation, certainty falling apart, medical problems, stress, and a million or one other things. But what I want to tell you is that we actually had tremendous happiness through the entire journey. And that doesn't mean we didn't have moments in our closet or even in the kitchen where we cried. But there were some pretty profound moments of joy throughout the entire journey, independent of the difficulties we encountered. How many of us relate to this? that I'm going crazy. Am I normal? I'm speaking with some of the families today, or over the last few days, you know, there's this feeling like, I just feel like I'm going crazy, and is this right? Am I normal? And one thing I want to point out is that we just don't need, in the midst of struggle, to feel shame for being human. That we have our moments where we have self-doubt and we're worried about, am I making the right decisions? Is what I feel normal? And as far as I can tell, anything anyone's ever told me about where they are, their feelings of worry and discouragement or depression or whatever, is normal. And you're quite okay. Happiness is not a destination. We know that, but oftentimes we forget. It's a way of traveling, however. Happiness is a way of traveling, despite a million and one setbacks. So now I want to share with you, as though this were a metaphor for the road of life, what happens, some decisions we can make that contribute to happiness and others that contribute to despair. And I'm going to share about four things per side. So gratitude. Gratitude is something we can do every single day that contributes to our sense of peace and joy. And by contrast, comparison can take that away from us. I see this all the time where people say, oh, this family looks so perfect. They look like they got it all together. They look so happy. I don't know a single family that doesn't have real trouble, real struggles. Some just hide it better than others. But we do ourselves a disservice when we try to compare that maybe they've got it a little better, that somehow they've got it all figured out and I don't. We're all trying to figure it out. Gratitude turns what we have into enough. By contrast, comparison is an illusion that robs us of joy. There's another really beautiful quote that says, "Blessed are they who see beautiful things in humble places where other people see nothing." That is a truism that I hope we can all grasp. And I've tried to practice that my whole life. There was one occasion when Mitchell was home on hospice. And I was helping him in his bath, and he had a pump in his arm, pumping milrinone into his heart. And it was bruised and sore and uncomfortable and awkward. And he said softly, pointing to it, "I just wish I didn't have this in my arm. I didn't have to have this." And then he sat for a second, and then he thought, and he said, "Well, at least I'm alive." If anyone had a reason to complain, it was him. But he said, "At least I've got this. I'm alive right now, and I'm making the most of what I've got." I remember going out into my hallway, back against the wall, slid to the floor, and just wept because of the profound lesson that my little boy taught me. Cicero said, "Gratitude is not only the greatest of virtues, it's the parent of all others." And if you think about any virtue in life, it probably stems back from somebody that's grateful. Last quote I'll share, and we'll move on to some stories. Happiness doesn't depend on what we have, but it does depend on how we feel toward what we have. And this last line is great. We can be happy with little and miserable with much. Some of the most miserable people I know have a lot, and having things doesn't make us happy. I remember, as we rushed Mitchell into the hospital to figure out what was going on, we were really, really scared. And my wife and I went down and we picked up this little teddy bear in the souvenir shop to kind of comfort Mitch, give him something soft to hold on to as he was having all these tests taken. And there was a little coin there that said gratitude. And I got that and I put it in my pocket I bought it, but then I put it in my pocket. But I've always tried to practice gratitude while the sun was shining, because it conditioned me when things got really hard to just learn to be grateful. And you know what I did? I went up into the SICU, the cardiac intensive care unit, and just was so grateful that I had right then. That's all I had. It's all I cared about. I just got right now. And I was so grateful for that. Oh, I lied. Here's another quote. "It's not joy that makes us grateful. These are just so fun. They're just little truisms that we can cling to. But gratitude, it's gratitude that makes us joyful." It's not joy that makes us grateful, it's gratitude that makes us joyful. One last, in matters of gratitude, I love this, okay? Practice makes what? Perfect. Okay, I'm going to change it, because we always think perfect. Well, We're not perfect, right? Some days I might stumble in areas of gratitude, but practice makes permanent. Keep working at it. Keep working at finding ways to be grateful, and you'll find that your joy in life will be increased significantly. The next thing I want to talk about is moments, things we can do to create moments that matter, okay? And by contrast, we can forget about collecting things, because those things often get in the way of joy. We've probably heard this before, collect moments, not things. I had a lot of experiences throughout our journey with Mitchell where I was always trying to collect moments and I would capture them as much as I could. In fact, we all have cameras, right? We may not be photographers, but we all have phones. So take as many pictures as you can of the ordinary moments and you'll be grateful for them in the future. See, the trouble is we often think that it's these great, grandiose experiences that bring us joy. And it's the ordinary stuff of life that is not worth paying much attention to. But I'm going to show you some examples with my son where quite the opposite occurred. The ordinary stuff was the most magical. Now, I put Disneyland kind of in the middle because I like Disneyland. And the only time I'm miserable is when it's hot and I'm in a long line. But so it's not quite despair, but it can be there sometimes. Okay, so there's a theme park in our area, and I remember we would go on a regular yearly basis, we'd go up to the theme park, it's like a miniature Disneyland, not quite as cool, but still some fun rides, and Mitch always enjoyed that. And, you know, as the sun began to set, it was a long day. Everyone was tired, they were laughing, you know, and we changed outfits about four times because they'd do the wet rides and want to get dry again. But as the sun was setting, something interesting happened. Something more beautiful and magical than all the rides of the day combined. And it was this. They all wanted to jump inside this water feature and splash around and play. And that was the most beautiful, fun experience they had. It's the thing they talked about for a long time afterwards. On another occasion, I went camping with my kids, and it was probably 3,000 degrees below zero. And my wife, I was coming home from work, and I said, will you just throw my tent in my truck and kind of help me get ready? We're going to take the boys camping. And she was so cute. She runs in and grabs a tent but didn't look at it. It was kind of a mosquito net, and it didn't really have much covering. It was so cold, so cold. I turned to Mitchell in the middle of the night, and I said, do we need to go? And he was like, no, let's stick with it. Let's do it. So we did. The next morning, this is what little Wyatt said, my youngest.
Did you have fun camping? It was like 3,000 degrees below zero, huh? But we survived, huh?
No, we're not yet.
Yeah, we're not dead yet.
Yeah, because it's very cold out here. And it's cold as the Arctic.
As cold as the Arctic?
Yep.
Did we see any Arctic snakes in the snow?
I feel them go up my back, yes. Last night.
You felt one go up your back last night?
I didn't see any snakes, and I kept telling him there were no snakes. He goes, I swear there was one, Dad. So just little cute moments that exist in the in-betweens, and I'm going to talk about that in just a few minutes. Some of the most beautiful experiences I've ever encountered, the things I loved the most, were surrounded by difficulty, the hard, the cold, the long, the hot and sweaty, whatever, those kinds of experiences that were a little uncomfortable tended to have a deeper impact on our family for some reason. Now, on another occasion, we took our family down to Chichen Itza and all these other places, ancient America, and saw the sights, and you know, that was fun. It was all right, right? My kids didn't appreciate how interesting it was. As an adult, you kind of think, wow. But at the end of the day, we went to the beach. And we began to play in the water, and our kids really, really loved that. We could have gone to a local lake and had the same amount of fun with them. But Mitchell got really tired, and he laid on the shore, upset that he couldn't play like the other boys. And my heart broke, and my wife saw that and ran to him and picked him up and brought him into the water. And they began to play, and she began to comfort him. And one of my favorite photos happens here in just a minute, that she gently walked him out into the water, and Mitch laid back on his back, and she would just kind of roll him around. And you know, the most beautiful experience of that trip wasn't the ancient ruins, wasn't this lavish thing. It was the ordinary. It was the moment in between. So when you look, when I were to compare on a scale these two experiences, what do you think weighs more to me? What has more weight and value? It was those ordinary moments. I'm going to share one more example, and this could have saved me a ton of money when I was younger. We would go to Costco every year, it seemed, and buy one of these little bouncy floaty houses things. And it was fun, right? All the kids would come over, they'd play for 20 minutes. And it was cool. Mitch had a good time, all my kids had a good time, but it wasn't later. Maybe a half hour later, it was all quiet up there. And I went up there and I saw a little fort. Okay, and I'm like, well, wait a minute, what's going on? And I saw some movement in there, and then I saw my little boys who had made a fort out of a plastic, you know, PVC pipes and a little tub or whatever that thing is, a pool, and some towels. And they were having a time of their life, and they spent their entire day playing in there. So the economics of kids are very curious to me. Okay? I could have saved a lot of money, not on car insurance, but PVC pipe and towels. But, and so, you know, and that was my kids' reaction. The pool was cool, Dad, that was fun. But when it came to the cheap stuff, they went crazy. And I did this. So I found that even, like, this was Christmas morning, my little boy would jump inside the box and play in there. And it was just so much fun. If I realized that cardboard boxes would be more fun than the toys we bought them, then we would have done things a lot differently. This was little Mitch, as a very young boy, constructing box forts out of old boxes. And we always tried to save them. And as he got a little older, we were finishing our basement, we bought a bathtub, had a huge box, and he said, Mom, can I sleep in this for a while? So for a month and a half, he slept in the living room in a box. And it was awesome. And, you know, we'd have guests come over and we'd said, this is our little bedroom, you know. So it was cute. And you'll notice there's a little hole over there. He made me cut out a hole so he could put his chargers in there, and it was really fun. And, you know, Natalie would come in and tuck him in at night. And then I would just kind of spy on him, not in a creepy way, but just as a daddy way, and watch him look at his little devices and kind of have fun in his little fort. So we've got this theme. You guys know what this means? There's a variation of it, but in our family, it's down to build box forts. So if my kids want to build box forts anytime, anywhere, I'm down. And in fact, I did a Google search yesterday and found these really inspirational pictures about what I could do with boxes. So you're welcome. Have fun at home. The point is that we can have fun in the journey independent of where we are in life. And when Mitch got especially weak with his arms, my sons would gather around him and build a fort around him. He'd just sit there. And he'd make this fort, and then he'd watch our family movies in his little fort. It was really fun. Here's an experience where I failed. I was trying to create a moment at Olive Garden. He loves that place. And I was trying to kind of edge him to go do his, like, tell the waiter or the server what you want. You know, I didn't want to have to do it for him. And watch how he rolls his eyes at me.
Okay, oh, Dad's gonna order from
Wait, what do you want, Mitch?
Remember?
No.
Yes, you do.
Okay, he wants basically tour of Italy minus the...
Okay, we're gonna watch that one more time, so...
Okay, oh, Dad's gonna order from
Wait, what do you want, Mitch?
Remember?
No.
Yes, you do.
Okay, he wants basically tour of Italy minus the lasagna, so, like, just...
So, you know, you win some, you lose some, that's all right, right? And, but what I want to mention to you, and this is where I'm spending the most time, and we'll go through a couple of ideas fast, but pay attention to the in-betweens, because the very best moments you will ever have in your life are in the in-between. And I'll explain what that means. 95% of our life is pretty mundane, it's pretty ordinary. And we might find that there's some high points and low points. High points could be a fun vacation, a new home, a new job, whatever, and the opposite, you know, can happen. But most of our life is the routine. And that's where the magic happens. When I look back on my life with Mitch, I don't wish I was back in Chichen Itza or Disneyland. I don't really care about that. I care about the ordinary moments talking to him in the backyard. And that's the one point. And so here are some pictures I took of just little in-between moments. Mitch having a great conversation with his grandpa. My wife having a dance party in the kitchen. Natalie helping Laura Ashley practice the piano. This is the stuff life is made of, reading books at bedtime. Buddies hanging out in the backyard. Quiet conversations in the bedroom as I'm tucking my kids to sleep. Helping our kids learn to do things for the first time. Watching my in-laws steal my mobile cooler. Sweet conversations. As Mitch was getting sick, Ethan would go in his room every single night to have a conversation, just to see how his day went. And oftentimes Ethan would have this, he'd try to push Mitch as fast as he could, and they'd just have a blast on his wheelchair. It's these ordinary moments. In one of my essays I'd written on my blog, I said, I miss everything in between. I miss everything that was ever routine. And you know, that informs me even in my own grief journey. And we all deal with grief on some level, right? But if I grieve for the ordinary, that informs me that I should be paying attention to the ordinary and investing my time and energy in the ordinary, because that's where life is made of. Oh, here again, the days are long, but the years are short, and it's easy to forget that. Okay, so really quickly, you know, there was a study done as to where does happiness come from scientifically. Now, this is one voice, one study, and one of them said our predilection, our propensity for happiness can be genetic. We can inherit a disposition to be grumpy or happy or whatever. Another one is behavior, that we can make choices that contribute to our sense of joy. And then lastly, there's circumstances. And what was surprising is that circumstances, you know, what you had, where you lived, what you look like, had very little to do with real happiness. So we have roughly, according to this study, a 50-50 shot at being happy, right? What I suggest is that we can do something, at least with our choices, to increase our odds of greater joy. Now, there's a thief, there's an alter ego we have that can steal joy from us without us even realizing it. Let me give you an example. I'm going to throw a couple of numbers up on the screen. They're going to be randomized, and I want you to find the numbers in order and count from 1 to 30 in 30 seconds, okay? So you're going to see a bunch of numbers. I want you to look for one, then go find two, go find three. Okay? And then this will have a point, I promise. Okay, you ready? Set? Go. I don't mean to stress you out, but you're halfway done. Okay, how'd you do? Who counted past five? Raise of hands. Okay, a couple. Who counted to two? It's okay, most people get three-ish, so you're okay. So I'm going to do something. I'm going to give you something that will make a difference. Okay, I'm going to throw the same numbers up there. Nothing will change, but I'm going to give you a grid, and I want you to look for the numbers in this order. Okay? Let's do it again. Same exercise. Ready, set, go. All right, so how'd you do? Did it make a difference? All right, so there's a principle here, and I'm not gonna spend a lot of time on this, but it's something that I see recurringly in our family, if we're not mindful, and I see it in people everywhere, that without the structure and a little priority, that sometimes we feel like we have to do too much. whether it's bills, taking care of stuff, whatever in our lives, we've got a million and one things that are tugging at us. And if we're not careful, we feel like we have to do everything. So one thing, the surest way to burn out or snap is to feel like you have to do everything all of a sudden, all the time. And that contributes, I think, a lot to taking away moments of joy, because we get so busy that we lose track of the things that matter most. So how does this work? Okay, what can we do? So I basically would take that grid and say there's things we have to do right this minute. There's things we need to do today, doesn't matter when. There's things we have to do every day, and you kind of get the point, right? Weekly, monthly, yearly. There's things you can just decide, oh, I got to figure out when I'm going to do this. Put that in a bucket, and then they'll do whenever, you know, just let it stay there in that bucket. And then lastly, we can throw things away. We can stop doing things that we feel like we have to do. If they don't contribute to your well-being or your family's well-being, throw it away. So here's how it works for me. I would list all the stuff I've got to do. And see, sometimes we just carry that subconsciously in the back of our minds, thinking, I got to do all this stuff. I'm so stressed. When, if I look at it properly, I can actually just start putting them in the right buckets. And then all of a sudden, I don't feel like I have so much to do. That I just need to focus on those two boxes. So just a little life hack that I think can make a difference in terms of our sense of well-being and not maybe feeling like we have everything to do all of a sudden, all at once. So I'm going to share with you a quick sliver of a time in my life where things were extremely busy. I was starting a new venture with a new company, and Mitchell was in heart failure. We took him to the hospital. We did an MRI. We found out he had a 5% ejection fraction, and we were stressed. I mean, I had bills to pay, employees to pay, and a son that was really in trouble. And this was the day we found out he was in huge trouble. Natalie just put a smile on and just tried to be as happy as she could with Mitch and not to frighten him. About a week later, my father-in-law comes walking up the driveway, and I had everything in the world to do, but I decided, you know, I'm gonna stay home and I'm gonna watch this. I'm gonna be here, part of the family. And he brought Mitch a little puppy. So I'm gonna watch this, we're gonna watch a short little video about when Mitch first met his puppy. And I decided to put all the busy stuff in my life aside so I could be in the moment, this tender moment.
Oh yes, come in.
So that was a beautiful moment for my family. And by the way, I didn't make this video for this presentation. I made that in the moment. Like that day he got it, that night when everyone was asleep, I was putting it together. And I'm going to share another video in a few minutes in conclusion that was something we made in the moment. It was reflective, not of a rosy reflection of the past, but of that was our reality, and that was how we were reacting to it, because we were practicing gratitude. But moments matter, right? And you got to spend time investing in those little ordinary moments. The most beautiful and happy moments I have ever experienced were punctuated with tears. Happy tears, sad tears, and everything in between. Another thing that contributes to our sense of well-being and joy and happiness are relationships. And by contrast, isolation does just the opposite. And very, very quickly, Harvard started a study a little over 80 years ago. And they asked the question, what if we could watch people's lives like a movie through time? What would we learn about human happiness? Well, they had a lot of thoughts of what they might discover. And by the way, this study is ongoing. It's continuing to this day. They tracked about 742 people. And Harvard, they're kind of smart, you know. They kind of know what they're doing. But and they've now added 2,000 descendants of these people into the study. And there's no sign of it stopping. I mean, and I need to also mention, studies like this are exceedingly rare because they run out of budget. The researchers get distracted. But because this was funded by an institution like Harvard, they're really serious about this. And so the data they've got is exceedingly rare and insightful. They decided to break the audience into two, privileged silver spoon kind of audience of youth, and then the others were kids found in the tenements and very kids that had to deal with abject poverty. And they said, what's going to be the difference as their lives play out as to whether they'll be happy? Will their circumstance have much at anything to do with their happiness? Well, what they discovered, and Robert Waldinger, the guy you see in the picture there, he's the third guy to now run this study. He's taken it over, the third generation to do this, and he just has a brilliant TED Talk. I encourage you to go look it up. But he said, when the study began, nobody cared much about empathy or attachment. But it turns out the key to happiness and aging is relationships, relationships, relationships. There were three big lessons they learned. Social connections are really good for us. Now, whether you've got a significant other or just best friends, it's important to have relationships that we can connect with. And so that's really big. The second one is that the quality of those relationships matter, not the quantity. We know that, right? And that lastly, good relationships are not only good for our bodies, but really good for our minds. So my point here, and this is a topic in and of itself, but to invest our energy in relationships, and because that contributes to our well-being, not only with our children or significant other, but other people that we can connect with, that we can have a healthy life. And you know, again, good relationships keep us happier and healthier, period. Okay, so lastly, the last thing I'm gonna quickly mention is meaning and purpose, is another way to find joy in the journey. Circumstance often has very little to do in the end with overall happiness. There's a paradox here, and I'll go over that in just a moment, but you probably all heard of Viktor Frankl, right? He and his family were put in a Nazi Germany concentration camp, and his whole family was decimated. He was the only survivor of his family. He wrote one of the most profound books I've ever read, called Man's Search for Meaning. And in that, he began to deconstruct his experience, these horrific things he experienced. And one of the things he discovered is he said, the very pursuit of happiness will often thwart happiness. Isn't that ironic? The very thing we're chasing can sometimes be the thing that gets in the way of it. And one of the things he mentions is searching for things of purpose and meaning. Think of one of the things that you've done in the last month that made you really happy, okay? Now, I want to share a grid here really quickly. The vertical axis is the degree of happiness we feel, and then over time. There are things that we find pleasurable, right? Barbecues, going to the pool, watching a movie, whatever. And then there are things that we're passionate about. And these are things that just really kind of fill our cup. For me, it's photography. Other people, it's sports. It can be anything. It can be writing. Then lastly, there's things of meaning and purpose, and these things transcend material things, okay? And in matters of happiness, sometimes I think we confuse the short-term pleasures with long-term fulfillment. And that doesn't to say that there's nothing wrong with doing things that are pleasurable or things we're passionate about, but sometimes we get stuck there and we're just, you know, splashing in the shallow end of life. And so I found it helpful for me to occasionally take stock of where am I spending the majority of my time, and am I paying attention to things of transcendent value? One personal example I'll quickly share with you is everyone knows I love taking photographs. I love portrait photography. I love going out and telling people stories. One day I want to just leave the world behind and go travel the world and tell people's stories, because I think you are all remarkable. I'd love to tell all of your stories. But camping is really one of my passions too. And so I could do this in isolation. I could just take off and go camping and, hey, see you guys later, right? But I chose to bring my family along and connect something I'm passionate about, and is fun, with something of meaning and purpose. And so, and my son, Ethan, he is a budding cinematographer, and so I'm trying to help him develop that craft. But boy, this young man, I'm not a doting father, he literally is, he's surpassed me in a lot of ways in terms of cinematography, he's quite good. And it's so we go out and we work on these things together, and I'm trying to connect things I love. Now, sometimes our kids won't be passionate about things we're passionate about, and that's okay. This was last year in Oregon when we went out and shot the eclipse, and that was amazing. That was really cool. You know, my kids' favorite experience, this was one of the most profound experiences we had. It's just unbelievable. But their favorite part of the whole journey was like the 15-hour drive, right? The economy of kids, right? No, I'm kidding. It was really fun because we talked about all kinds of fun stuff, and so that was awesome. That was really fun. So I think the key, if you can start to look at, analyze your life, what things bring us pleasure, what are we passionate about, and what brings us meaning and purpose, and can we link those as often as possible, I promise you're going to have a happier, more fulfilling life. I promise. Seek for meaning first, meaning and purpose first, and happiness will inevitably follow. So that's it. That's what I wanted to share today. And I would just suggest practice gratitude, practice gratitude, practice gratitude. Am I being too subtle? It works. Gratitude is great because your life will fall apart and you'll still look at the lint in your pocket and go, at least I've got that. Sir Thomas Brown said, I'm the happiest man alive. He figured it out. He practiced. He said, I'm the happiest man alive. I have that in me that can convert poverty into riches, adversity into prosperity, and I am more invulnerable than Achilles. Fortune hath no one place to hit me. This was an image I used in the beginning of Mitchell's journey as it was really coming to a head, because to me it was metaphorical of the experience we were having. And so during this time, it was right after we learned Mitchell had end-stage heart failure. This is the last little piece I'm gonna share with you. This was a video where we had every reason to be frustrated and sorrowful and just be mad at the world. But we decided we were going to look at what things we're grateful for. And this is the message we sent out to those that were supporting our family at the time. Thank you. So that was a snapshot in just really the depths of our hardship. We chose to look at gratitude. We chose to look at things that would that made our hearts full, keep us from sinking. There's a lot of meaning behind that image there, and I think we can seek after those moments. And the one thing I always share every time I try to speak to an audience is that I just want you to look back on your life a year from now or a lifetime from now and be glad you lived the life you lived. Thank you for your time.